So, welcome once again to Bob Conference, our first talk on this side of the room today. And it's going to be given by Franz Thoma. He is a consultant software engineer at TNG Technology Consulting in Munich. He's a functional programmer who started off with compilers and discovered his love for functional programming. Today he is going to give us a talk on reactive streaming with Akka Streams, and later today he's also given a tutorial in Haskell, or on Haskell. So, well, without further ado, the stage is yours and fun.
Yeah, welcome to Bob Conference. I'm going to talk today about Akka Streams. Please feel free to ask questions during the talk. I think we have plenty of time for answering questions also during the talk, not only at the end. So the project I'm currently working on is a big data application. There are a number of challenges when streaming big data applications. So what we do, we have billions of events per day. That's in the terabyte range. We need to do part of this processing near real time. So we don't have time to buffer or collect events and then batch them later. A lot of the processing has to be done stateless and as soon as the data arrives. We also need to do this in a very fault-tolerant way. So we can't really react to any faults in singular events and singular records. We have to deal with quite regular failure of some records, and we have to deal with this in a way that the application still can run on, so we can cope with this. There are two kinds of processing, of streaming. That's the bounded and unbounded streaming. So bounded streaming basically is something like batch processing. You start a stream, you do something with the data, you write it to some output, and then you're done. The other kind is unbounded streaming, which means that your stream runs and runs and runs on and on for days, for weeks, for years maybe. And you don't, you never want to break the stream. You always want to continue. Akka Streams supports both. So, and actually, we do some part of our streaming is done as unbounded streams. So the data ingress and egress is generally unbounded, but you can break down those unbounded streams into several bounded streams. So in this way you can achieve fault tolerance for a smaller bounded stream inside a great big unbounded stream. Yeah, why we use it? Well, it's type safe. So already at compile time, it is checked that your data your data definitions are compatible. It's compositional. You can reuse parts of your flow at other places. It's quite a high-level language. So you're not concerned with the ugly details of streaming. You have a very high-level language to say what you really want. And on the other hand, it still has explicit semantics. That's very important for us. There are other streaming solutions that try to figure out the best thing for you. That try to figure out what you want, and a lot of times they will get it right, and sometimes they will get it wrong, and then you have to start debugging. And one thing I particularly like about Akka Streams is that the defaults are quite sensible, and if you have to deviate from the defaults for some reason, then you can do this explicitly, and it will behave very deterministically. And the last point is it integrates very well. So there are a lot of connectors to other systems like HTTP, Amazon, AWS, and so on, where you don't need to write all those connectors yourself. you just you can just use them off the shelf. Well, and it's actually very fast, and it does do a lot of optimization under the hood. In particular, Stream Fusion is done automatically, and that works very well. So, I'm going to start with a small example. So that's a very, very simple streaming program. We start with basically a constant source. So the numbers 1, 2, and 3. We will send those via a flow. That flow maps all the numbers to their increment. And we will send those to a sync. This sync is, in this case, just print each item on the standard out. And we will run the stream. So this is an example for bounded stream. It's bounded because you have only 3 items, and it will finish as soon as the last item is processed. And we can visualize this. So this is where the composition comes in. We start with the source. The source will send its item via the flow and then to the sync. And those are already the basic building blocks for Akka Stream. So those are the types. We have sources that that produce elements of type of some type A. We have flows that consume elements of some type A and produce elements of some type B. Those may be correlated one to one, so each incoming item produces one outgoing item, but they needn't be. So you can also a flow can also be something like FlatMap. You get one item and produce 0 or several items, and they also can perform I/O. So for example, the sending a request to a web server is also a flow. It takes a request, it produces responses. They are correlated one to one, but they are actually doing this via I/O. And then we have syncs, and those take items of type A and consume them. And if you put all those together, then you get a fourth type. That's the runnable graph. Runnable graph doesn't take any input, it doesn't produce any output. So everything it does actually is via I/O. But there is one arrow here. That's materialized value. So even if you run, even if you have something that doesn't produce any data or consume any data, but does only I/O, it still can produce something. These so-called materialized values, they can give you some kind of introspection on the stream. For example, if you write something to a file, you'd like to know if writing to the file was successful. So this sync returns you a materialized value of future of I/O result. And as soon as the stream has finished, so this is for bounded streaming only, obviously. If the stream was successful, then it will you give a okay I/O result. If it was not successful, then it will give you an error result. And you will only get the answer when the stream is actually finished, so you get a future back. There are some other types for this materialized value. Of course, sometimes you don't have any actual information, so you just put in not used. That's basically unit, but with a different name. You could, for example, collect the number of elements that are processed, or the success or failure of an I/O action. And also there are syncs that collect the elements themselves and give you a list or some sequence of the collected elements. And you can collect the elements from a stream and then do something with them. Since the materialized value is accessible instantly, as soon as the stream starts, but the stream won't be finished for quite some time, probably. You only get a future handle, so most of them are future handles. Only the not used, that's available instantly, of course, but all the others are usually futures that give you, as soon as the stream is finished, the final value. So now we can connect those elements. You have already seen, you have the via and to methods for combining sources, sinks, and flows. And those are the four possibilities. So you can combine a source with a flow, you get another source. You can combine a flow with another flow, you get another flow. You can pipe a flow to a sink, then you get a new sink with the flow prepended, and you can combine a source and a sink, and you get a runnable graph, and that's the thing then you can execute then. There are also, so by default, the materialized value. You see here, we have a mat materialized value and a mat 2, and you, in the end, we have only the left one. Now, if we have a sink and we want the information from that sink, then we need to combine those materialized values. There are also additional methods that allow you to specify what to do with the left and the right materialized value. Basically, you can keep either one, or you can combine them to a pair, or add them, whatever you like. So the materialized value you have here in the end, you can build this up from the parts of your stream. For example, what we actually do, we have an HTTP service that receives chunks of data, and at each processing stage, we produce some metrics, and those metrics are always combined to a response builder or metrics. So it's a collector that collects the metrics, and each processing stage will push its own metrics into the response, and then in the end, that's what we send back to the client in order to tell it everything went fine, or there were 5% errors or something like that. Now, up until now, our flows were very linear. We can also add T pieces, so you can split up your stream and distribute your data to different sinks. You can send the data from a source also to some sink, and you still get a source back. So you send the data to one sink, but you still get the same data as a new source and can pipe that to another sink. In this way, you can build quite complex graphs. There are also possibilities to fan in, to combine streams. Basically, anything is possible except for building cyclic graphs. That wouldn't be good. But everything else you can fan out. So it's a directed acyclic graph, basically, you build from this. So here are some examples for sources, sinks, and flows. The easiest source we have already seen, that's the source that builds from a set of elements. You just specify an iterable where the of the elements you want to publish, you want to push downstream. Then the simplest sink is that just ignores the elements. So maybe you just want to count the elements, do something with them, and then pipe them nowhere. You can do something for each item. You can fold. You can fold on the items, and for example, produce a sum, produce a count, whatever. Then we come to the flows. The easiest flow is the one from a function. So it maps values one to one. You just specify a function, and you get back a flow. In the I/O department, you have files, for example. Get lines or chunks of byte strings from a file. You pipe chunks of byte string to a file. That works very similarly for any kind of binary storage. So if you want to pipe to S3 or to Kafka or whatever, there are very similar sinks and sources. And as an example for HTTP, so basically Akka HTTP simply also uses under the hood the Streams API. So if you have an outgoing connection, so something where you can pipe requests and get back responses, that is a flow of request to response. On the other hand, your handler on the server side, so this is the HTTP client, the HTTP server requests from you, so you give the HTTP server a flow from request to response that answers the incoming requests and returns outgoing responses. So that all integrates very nicely. Now, we have built our sources, sinks, flows, put everything together. Now, how is this actually run? Those sources and sinks are reusable. You can, they don't have an identity. You can reuse them everywhere. What Akka Streams then does when you use the run method is build an actual implementation of that flow in your for this invocation. It materializes it. Actually, they use the Akka actor model under the hood, but you don't see any of this. That's just the implementation. You see only those streams. And under the hood, they use actors. And that's what the run method does. And that allows a lot of optimizations. For example, stream fusion is possible. So if you have several stages of flow and another flow and another flow, then they can fuse together those flows and make everything much faster. So you gain a lot of performance to this fusion. You have a question.
Is it pull or push or both or?
It's both.
Right.
It's both. So we come to that in a minute. Right. I'm going to talk about back pressure, but basically yes, it's push and pull. So the downstream can specify, can say, hey, give me some more elements. I can, I'm waiting. And the upstream can say, here's the next bunch. Please process that. And it works both ways. That's very important because some sources they rather like to push. For example, if you have an HTTP server, then requests come in as fast as the client requests. So you need to be push based. On the other hand, from the file system, you want to be pull-based because you want to get data just as fast as you can process.
Well, but for the HTTP server, it might also be that they send you more requests than you can handle,
yes,
right? And then you don't
yes.
want to balloon them in
yeah.
memory.
So that's actually the next chapter. So back pressure. Back pressure basically is the downstream, any downstream component can say, well, slow down, I need some more time. One example is, so we have, when we read things from a file, that's quite fast. It's I/O, so it's not the fastest thing, but it's quite fast. Then you split those chunks at new lines, that's very fast because it's basically just a processor doing something, just a CPU. Then you want to send those, actually that's not fault from function, it's flow from function. Flow from function. You send this via HTTP to somewhere. That's very slow because we have network latencies. And then you write it to the console or something, and that's very fast again. And so what back pressure does is, since any component can say, give me more items or slow down, I can't cope with the items right now, everything is just as fast as the slowest component in the flow. So that's here the HTTP thing. The slowest link in the chain will determine the throughput. That's, on one hand, that's a good thing. On the other hand, if you have a producer that produces faster than you can cope with, then of course that's a bad thing. For example, you have an HTTP service, the client sends you requests too fast, then at some point the server will just turn away requests, or they will run into timeout or something. So you have explicit control over the back pressuring. For example, you can put in there a buffer. Buffer of size 50 will buffer up to 50 requests. So if you have a peak where someone sends just too many requests for a short time, then you can just buffer them. And if the peak continues to be too long, then at some point we will just drop new requests. So everything will still be just as fast as the slow sync, but at some point we will probably lose data. We can also try to back pressure. So up to 50 records can just be buffered, and then the default back pressuring will, and then we will push the back pressure upstream again. But only if the buffer is full. Yes.
Could you make it lazy? I mean, if you specify buffer to zero, for example, would your upstream be never executed if it's not requested?
No, the pull still works through a buffer. So if the buffer is empty and the downstream tries to pull the next item, then it will just get that through the buffer and will pull from the upstream directly.
So there's no way to make it completely lazy, like completely
push only. By lazy you mean push only? I don't think
pull
so.
On, pull only.
Sorry, pull only. Yeah. No, push. Are you talking about? So only if the upstream pushes something, but not if the downstream requests anything.
If downstream is not requesting anything, upstream is never executed.
Okay. depends on the upstream. But usually, if the downstream is never executed, then the upstream
is never requested.
That's actually basic behavior. Yeah. Okay. That's default behavior. So if the of course the upstream is a constant producer, so it just takes a list and produces the items, then it will still have the list in memory, but will not send anything downstream. So usually the semantics are the stream finishes when the downstream finishes or the upstream finishes. Usually it's both. So if the downstream consumer finishes without consuming anything, then the stream just will be ended. Yeah. Okay. So that's controlling the that's buffering. There are also other stream shaping methods. For example, we can throttle. If we have a sink that can't quite back pressure correctly, but will just fail if too many items come in, then, and you have a fast producer, then of course you run into problems all the time. So what you can do is you throttle. For example, you can throttle to 5 elements per second. And you do that in a shaping way. So you apply back pressure upstream if the throughput gets too high, and then you can take off the load from that choking sink, and it hopefully will cope with the items coming in slower. So, for example, that's what you can do. You can avoid denial of service against the web server. If a web server will just shut down or run into timeouts if there are coming in too many requests, then you can do some throttling. So, usually everything works fine, but if there are there if there's a load peak, then you will still apply back pressure. Back pressure can also be applied for substreams. So if for example you have two sinks, one is fast, one is slow, and you want to send the data to the fast sink directly without buffering, but you still want to cope with load peaks. So for the slow sink, you need something like a buffer, and that's so you can split off a subflow here and only apply the buffering to this subflow, and the main flow will still receive the data unbuffered. So those are so-called boundaries. Parts of your stream can have different back pressuring mechanisms than other parts of your stream. And then there's batching. So you can also collect items to batches and then send batches downstream, which is particularly useful. For example, you don't want to do an HTTP request for each event. You want to batch 1,000, 10,000, 100,000 events and then send them as one request. Okay. So that's about the back pressuring. Now, actually, Akka Streams does support a more powerful DSL for generating streams that are more complex. So we've already seen the they do this via under this sources sinks flows DSL, there's a so-called graph DSL that actually models the graph of a of this, so that directly models the streaming graph, and we can use shapes for this. So you already know the source, the shape of a source, which is a source shape. You know the shape of a flow, which is a flow shape. Sync has a sync shape. You notice the type arguments A and B are exactly the same as in the sources, sinks, and flows, but this materialized value is missing. So basically a flow is just something with a flow shape and a materialized value. And if you magnify this, then the flow shape is takes those two type arguments and it has one inlet and one outlet. Basically you can specify any shape with any number of inlets and outlets. For example, we have the uniform fanout shape, which also translates elements of type A to elements of type B. It has one inlet and then fans out to several outlets. So you just distribute the items to different outlets. This can be done in several ways. You can either just multiplex, so send one incoming item out to every outlet. You also can do this as a load balancer, round robin. So for each incoming item, you take the outlet with the least back pressure, for example, or even just really round robin. So the first, the second, the third, fourth outlet, and round and round. There are a lot of other shapes, and you can use those shapes to build flow elements that you can compose with the high level DSL. So, under the hood of a flow, there's just a graph that has a flow shape and a materialized value, and basically most of the DSL actually works with those graphs. So you don't actually need the flow on many places. The flow is just a decorator that gives you a lot of convenience methods. For example, the via method is defined on the flow, not on the graph. But there's a very simple way to decorate such a graph and get a flow back. But most of the time you can use them interchangeably. And some of the shapes that are useful, so we know source, sink, and flow shape. The runnable graph has a closed shape, so it doesn't accept any items. There's no type argument to the closed shape, doesn't accept any items, doesn't produce any items. You have different kinds of fanout shapes. So we've already seen the uniform fanout shapes. You have also fanout shapes and fan-in shapes that produce elements of different types. For example, we use this for error handling. You map something to an either of error or success, and then you can use a fanout shape that that pushes all the errors to one outlet and all the successful records to the other outlet. Same for the fan-in shape. And then you have also the bidirectional shape that has one downstream inlet, one upstream outlet, one upstream inlet, and one downstream outlet. So you can push items, for example. The bidirectional shape is used in the SSL layer of the HTTP server. So you get you get in a SSL encrypted request, will be decrypted to a normal request, will be processed, you get back a response, and the upstream channel of the bidirectional shape will then put on the SSL encryption and send back the encrypted response. I'm going to show you how this looks. So the graph DSL will be created from, you create a flow from a graph, and then you use the graph builder to, for example, we are going to balance between several workers. So we have a balancer and a merger, which are uniform fan out and uniform fan in. And for each worker, we're going to use, we're going to connect the outlet of the balancer with one of the workers and connect that to the inlet of the merger. So we fan out, process in parallel, fan in. We need to add this async boundary in order to, otherwise the items will be only processed one after the other. Due to this async boundary, they can be processed in parallel. So basically this async does actually disable stream fusion. If you leave this out, then everything will be fused together, and that's not that leads to sequential processing. And now in the end, we give back a flow shape, and we connect the in balancer, the inlet of the balancer, and the outlet of the merger with the outer flow. And what we get back is just a flow that looks not normal like any other flow. Inside, there's this balancing and merging. Okay. Now, I'm going to talk a bit about the connection to the outside world. So, as I said, Akka Streams is very rich in, has a very rich set of connectors. We have, of course, the HTTP server and HTTP client, so we can send requests to a server, respond. Behind this, the Flow API lies. We have a connector for JDBC, so Slick will actually allow you to stream from a database or stream to a database. Which is quite I just wanted to say it's quite slick. bad pun. Actually, if you want to retrieve a very large set of records, then Slick will enable you to do this in a streaming and constant memory fashion by automatically splitting up your select statement into smallish statements that will execute quite fast. and then just push items downstream as soon as they arrive. What we use quite heavily is Apache Kafka, which is a message broker basically. We have connectors for Apache Camel, which I actually haven't used, but I think Camel is quite widespread, and so Akka Streams has seamless integration with Camel. What we use very heavily is S3 and Kinesis, and there's a whole project. It's called Alpaca, with a vast set of connectors for Akka Streams. And well, that's the end of my talk. If you have any questions, now is the time. And thank you. I don't think so, but I haven't run into this problem actually. So what you of course always can do is run profiling over the application and see where most of the CPU time is consumed, or just look at JSTAC, and the stack frame with the highest probability to end up is probably the one with that consumes most of the CPU time. And of course, you can add buffers everywhere and look at the and have metrics write the buffer sizes, for example.
Yeah. What about runtime exceptions? Are they readable? Could you understand where things go wrong?
Yes. So I didn't talk about the entire error handling topic, but. You have supervision strategies for parts of your flow. You can either say, in case of a runtime exception, please just abort the flow, or you can specify to drop the element. So if one element causes an exception, then just drop this element and continue with the next one. So that's basically ignoring the exception. You can say, if an exception occurs, then stop the flow, but mark it as successful. So we have done everything we could, and now we can't do anything more, but still everything else was processed successfully. And you can do this for one flow element, or for a combination of several flow elements, or for the entire stream. And of course, if you propagate the exception, then you have to kill the flow at some point. But you usually don't want to do this. In particular, in our setting where we have billions of events, we don't want to kill an application or kill the flow just because some record was had some fault. We want to log the exception, drop the record, and then continue. Yeah?
I was wondering what you do about testing, how easy is it to test something like that? And aside from, of course, integration tests and something like that, mm-hmm. Are you able to test the components, the streams you're building up?
Yeah. So you can just, it's very composable. You can use one stream part connected to a source that pipes a thousand elements through and connect this to a sink that collects all the elements, and then you can assert on the result of the elements.
Okay.
Or you can do some assertions on the side effects, for example.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering, if you're side effecting, for example. I was wondering if how it works if you're piping, I don't know what the syntax was, also two?
Also two, yeah.
So if we're able to keep keep track of the state and then look for some things. Mm-hmm. Kind of like the question before.
So what you basically want is to assert on the on the results of the effects.
Okay.
You probably don't want to correlate exactly how the that, for example, those elements are written at the same time or something like that. You have to trust Akka there.
Okay.
But for example, if you want to split up a stream into two files after some predicate or something like that, then you usually generate some records with some invariant, so you know that 50% will end up in one sink and 50% will end up in the other sink, and then you just assert whether the distribution was 50-50 and whether all the records arrived actually in the sink. Also, of course, you want to test small components.
Mm.
So you can connect a flow that's supposed to do something with a collecting sink that doesn't interact with the file system, and then you have everything decoupled, and it's really quite easy to assert then.
Thank you.
Yeah. I would like to ask whether in real time when you put something in production,
mm-hmm.
is it common that you need to put everywhere buffers, because I don't know, maybe something happens and you lose tons of events and then they come?
No, you usually don't want to use buffers unless you really explicitly need them because of some restrictions, but usually you want to. So basically what buffers do is they increase memory usage and they increase the amount of in-flight data. And the less data you actually have in-flight in your application, the less data you can lose in case of a failure. So it's really, it's a good thing to keep the amount of buffering to a minimum in order to react to failures more quickly. Okay, so thank you again.